Good evening, viewers and the family of Green Pastures Tabernacle. It's a pleasure once again for us to have our Midweek Connect show, and we have a topic that we are working on. Kindly welcome your friends, share, let them know that we are here, send the link to them, and let us learn together. My name is Pastor Betty in Green Pastures Tabernacle, and this is Midweek Divine Connect. Welcome. Bishop, welcome.
Thank you.
Yes, kindly pray for us and then we start.
Father, we thank you this wonderful evening. We praise you for the day that you have given us today, and even the opportunity to sit together and receive instruction through discussions that come from your word. I pray that you inspire us, give us wisdom that will enrich somebody's life. Lord, I pray that you refresh and revive our viewers, those who are tired because of a day's long work and many other issues that they have had to contend with in the day. We thank you and we praise you for the value that we will receive here. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. Yeah. So there are, as we said, there are consequences that cannot be reversed. Like now, the empires that fall, that is it. Yeah. The organizations that fall, that is it. But there can be others, like maybe we can realign with divine protocol when we've strayed. So how can we do that?
Again, it depends on what needs to be realigned back. For example, when Adam and Eve sinned, God provided a way out for us. He gave us Jesus Christ, by whom, when we believe, just as the Bible says, by the way of one man, sin entered, and so death entered. In the same way, by way of one man, life is given back to us, and we are redeemed because of that same one man. So you find that in God's mercy, there is always a way to counter the failures of our weaknesses because of the infallibility that you talked about when you first asked the question. What I must underscore is, usually, even when there is a possibility to reverse or to realign, usually we live with some consequences. Like when you get injured, if you get a deep wound on your body, you will heal, but the scar will remain. And it's unfortunate where the scar is. If it is on the face, you may have to use a lot of makeup to cover it or just live with it. So anybody who sees you knows this person either had an accident or something happened. You can, and some scars of divine consequences of divine protocol are like that. We may be forgiven, we may realign, but something has already gone wrong. A child who dishonors their father early in life, they defy him, they run away, they lose time in terms of academics, they get involved in drugs, they might even come back home sick. So even when they come and they are forgiven, like the prodigal son, he was forgiven, but the fact remains he carried shame with him, and the realization that he will never, as much as he's forgiven, he will always live with the understanding that I was unruly, I left, and here I am, I am again. So sometimes there are things you can't avoid. They are there. It's just about the person knowing how to cope with that, so that they are not overwhelmed by the guilt themselves. But the fact is, where we can realign, I think we can do so. And I believe God can help us. The first thing that I believe we need to look at is just his word. Because God's word, remember, is the is a constitution that defines divine protocol. That's where we get what God wants. So we need to be people of the word. So the beginning point for anyone who wants to realign is to go back to the word. So if you're a Christian, you've got to go back to scripture, begin to study scripture and meditate on it, and then prayer. Prayer helps us to commune with God, to express our concerns, our fears, and then we wait for God to speak to us, to help us appreciate the space where we are in. And then godly counsel. I believe there are things that even after prayer and meditation of God's word, you may still need someone to come and now give you some practical wisdom on how to handle a particular thing.
Mm.
Because either you made a mistake and it has had a consequence,
mm-hmm.
how do you handle that on mm-hmm. a practical level?
Mm.
Because the Bible may not address your specific situation.
Uh-huh.
Yes, so in my view, mm-hmm. those are the few three ways that I think if we really want to realign
mm-hmm.
Back to divine protocol,
mm-hmm.
then we can use those three methods.
Mm-hmm.
And in my view, they should be able to put us at a place
mm-hmm.
where we may not be entirely 100% okay,
yes.
but at least we have a good place to rebuild our lives
mm-hmm.
and realign with what God wants us to be.
Wow, that's really,
yes.
that's helpful and assuring.
Yes.
Yes. When we think of divine protocol, I think we've spoken more looking at maybe organizations, the
mm-hmm.
church,
mm-hmm.
but let's bring it down to a believer's life.
Mm-hmm.
What impact does divine protocol have on a believer's personal life?
Mm-hmm.
Yes. And then, of course, is our experiencing of God's blessing dependent on obedience to divine protocol
mm-hmm.
on personal level?
I would say to the last question, yes, to a great extent.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, God is sovereign.
Mm-hmm.
And there are times that God will still bless us even when we don't deserve it.
Mm-hmm.
But when you look at dealings with God
mm-hmm.
and his people,
mm-hmm.
it looks like God will do his part and then have us do our part,
mm-hmm.
okay? No, most of the time,
mm-hmm.
right from Genesis,
mm-hmm.
he did the same with Adam. He told
yes.
him, I've built for you a garden,
mm-hmm.
I've grown it up,
yes.
so here it is. Your work is to tend
mm-hmm.
it
mm-hmm.
and eat.
Mm-hmm.
You are not planting.
Mm-hmm.
I've done my part.
Mm-hmm.
And then I will be coming to fellowship with you, you see?
Mm-hmm.
So to a large extent, I believe our experience of God's blessing is dependent
mm-hmm.
On our obedience to divine protocol. In fact, there's a scripture in Isaiah where God was telling the children of Israel, if you are willing and obedient,
yes.
you shall eat the good of the land.
Mm-hmm.
Willing and obedient
mm-hmm.
to what?
Mm-hmm.
To the things that I'm working with you on.
Mm-hmm.
And you remember the blessings and curses of Deuteronomy. Is it
28. Yes.
Yeah. If you know, the Bible says, "But if you
mm-hmm.
do this and do this
yes.
and do this and do this,
yes.
then I will
mm-hmm.
make you the head
mm-hmm.
and not the tail.
Mm-hmm.
You'll be blessed in the city and
yes.
in the country. You
mm-hmm.
bless as you go in and come out."
Mm-hmm.
So they are conditional.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So I believe it is important for us to agree that we can't just live the way we want.
Mm-hmm.
Plouting God's principles and expect
mm-hmm.
that our lives will just be fine because God loves us.
Mm-hmm.
In John 15 verse 1 to 4, when Jesus was speaking to his disciples,
mm-hmm.
he says, I'm the true vine and my Father is a vine dresser. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. And every branch that bears fruit, he prunes it, that may bear more fruit. So you see, there's a consequence.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, you may even be on the vine,
mm-hmm.
but being on the vine
mm-hmm.
is not there for fun. You need to bear fruit.
Mm-hmm.
So when you don't bear fruit, you are removed.
Mm-hmm.
But when you bear fruit,
mm-hmm.
instead of being removed,
mm-hmm.
you are pruned so that you increase
mm-hmm.
productivity.
Mm-hmm.
So there is expectation of what the Lord has on the branch that is on the vine. And then in verse 4, he says, abide in me. That's again conditional. And I in you. And as the branch cannot bear fruit on itself unless it abides in the divine, in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. So again, looks like there's a condition here. For us to bear fruit, then we have to abide in the vine. Meaning, if you don't abide, then you won't bear fruit. Okay? So that's why I'm saying that there is an impact. And our experience in God depends on how well we are aligned with his divine, you know, protocol. So that goes on then to say that divine protocol presents us with choices. And like I said earlier, choices have consequences. So going back again to what we saw earlier, what happens when we observe divine protocol? It also applies to human beings. When you walk in divine protocol, I believe you'll experience a well-ordered life. Okay? The Bible says in Proverbs 3, I think verse 5 and 6, that do not lean on your own understanding, but in all your ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct your paths. Okay? So meaning that if you acknowledge him, and then you trust the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. That's what the Bible says. So meaning that if you don't trust in the Lord and you don't lean on his understanding, then there is going to be a problem. So I believe, based on that simple verse right there, that when you observe divine protocol as an individual, you can experience a well-ordered life, because the Bible says the Lord will direct your paths. And then I believe it also improves relationships. Remember, we said that divine protocol also provides clear guidelines on how we relate with one another as believers and as people who are above us in authority and people who are subject to us. So when we understand God's heart concerning relationships, then it improves our relationships. Some of the things we do and fail is because we despise the order of God. And this applies even what I talked earlier concerning parents and their children. That's a relationship. There's a way that God wants that relationship handled. There's a relationship between employers and employees, what the Bible refers to masters and servants. There's a relationship between church leaders and the flock, you know, the shepherds that God has brought, all the fivefold ministry. So, and then the other one is what we said earlier. Generally, divine order, the way God has said divine order, is it simply maintains order and decorum. It's just decorum. For example, let's come back to the space of the family. You see, there is order when you know that that man and this lady are husband and wife. So there's a way we handle them and the ways they handle themselves. Okay? Now, remove divine protocol in marriage. So that means that anybody can be anybody's wife or husband. See, there's no decorum there. and there's no order.
Sounds like chaos.
Yeah, it's chaos. It's very chaotic. Okay? So I just gave that simple example, and that way you begin to see how serious it is when people despise the place of the things that God has said, that I want, according to what Paul said in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, that let every man have his own wife and every woman have her own husband, because that was supposed to bring in order and safety in the space of emotional and sexual relationships, without which then we are open to all manner of abuses and problems that come along with that. So for me, I believe there is an impact, and we need to know that if we don't follow through what God wants us to do, there will be consequences, and they are never good. Yes.
Yes, we move to aspect of the church. They say revival is dependent on God. Even if, okay, we can pray and ask for it, but it's God who can bring revival. So can we say that God's visitation and revival are connected to adherence to divine protocol?
Yeah, to answer that question, let me take you to Luke chapter 19, verse 43 to 44. Jesus was lamenting over Jerusalem, and he's saying, for days will come upon you when your enemies will build an embankment around you, surround you, and close you in on every side, and level you and your children within you to the ground, and they will not leave in you one stone upon another. And he gives a reason, because you did not know the time of your visitation. So it's like Jesus, although he's talking about a specific situation confronting Jerusalem as a city, but we can draw something here. So as much as God is sovereign, there are conditions also, I believe, that facilitate his involvement with us. Because God is sovereign, but there are times he will not force himself upon us. And that's why the first thing that I believe we need is we need to be aware. Jerusalem was not aware that the Messiah had come. Ignorance.
We need to be aware.
Yes, you need to be aware. Meaning, you need to deal with ignorance. That's why Hosea 4:6, the Bible says, my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. God wants to give you safety, but because of your ignorance, he is helpless. Of course, there'll be times God in his supernatural way will take care of you.
Yes.
But most of the time, especially when God has forewarned us and we are not willing, then he can't do anything for us.
Yes.
And that's why it is very important for us to appreciate the space. Jesus severally indicated that you don't, he said one time, those who are not sick do not require a doctor.
Yes.
So there has to be a need for you to have a, so he was simply saying the people who think they are okay spiritually don't need me. Leave them alone. Don't even call them to my meetings. Okay? Leave them alone because they will not. And another time he told them, don't throw precious pile in front of pigs because they don't know the value. Again, we come back to ignorance. So when we are not aware, when we are not ignorant, God may want to visit us. But if he does, we will not even know he came. And that is what happened to the nation of, the people of Jerusalem. The Messiah was right in their midst. But because of their ignorance, they never knew that he was there. And so that's why he wept and said, I wish you just knew your hour of visitation. But now, unfortunately, very soon, this magnificent city you see, and even the temple itself, not one stone will be left on top of the other. Okay? So the first one will be awareness. And then the other one, which seems to repeatedly come out, especially in the engagement of Jesus Christ and the people of his day, is hunger and thirst. Okay? In Matthew 5:6, the Bible says, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled. This feeling, in my view, is a way of, you know, God coming through. Not necessarily the way we talk of revival, like there's a move of God, people are getting saved, but just being filled with godliness and the love of God at an individual level is also revival.
Yes.
Because revival can be individual.
Yes.
Where you go, you just get revived. Mm-hmm. That your life is energized and amplified to higher levels of experience and relationship with God. But then again, when he was talking about the Holy Spirit in John chapter 7, verse 37 to 38, he says, on the last day, that great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried out, if anyone thirsts, again, Jesus gives a condition. Meaning, if you don't thirst, this is not for you. If anyone thirsts, let him come to me and drink. And then he who believes in me, as the scripture said, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water. So basically, I'm saying yes, without ruling out the sovereignty of God. Because every time we deal with godly issues, we must always leave space for God to act in a way we don't know. We should never say God can never visit people. God can visit people even when they didn't seek him, just to prove himself. So we should always, because what happens again, when we make it conditional for God to do things, we actually take away his sovereignty. And I've had many well-meaning, especially Pentecostal Christians, who are very dogmatic about saying, you know, God can never do anything on earth unless we allow him. Now, that's a good statement. But if you think about it seriously, what it is saying is that God is no longer sovereign. In other words, then it means if we all fail, and you know we are capable of failing, then God's purposes are completely thwarted, which, in my view, beats the theology of God. Because if we have a weak theology of God, then we will mishandle him. And one of the ways of seeing the weakness of the theology of God is when we rule out God in things and don't allow his sovereignty. A good example is sending Jesus to the earth. Sincerely, we had nothing to do with his coming. Yeah. God simply loved us and he decided to send his son here. When Adam and Eve sinned, they didn't possibly ask God to clothe them. They decided to clothe themselves because, one, they were too guilty to even think they could ask God to clothe them. So they had to look for the easiest way to clothe themselves, but God in his mercy, the Bible says he killed an animal and covered their nakedness. That is a God we serve. So God would have been so mad and say, look, I gave you a garden. I made sure everything is fine, but you still went ahead and messed. So he would have said, okay, you stay like that. Okay, but then God in his mercy decided, okay, these leaves, how often will they keep sowing leaves? Because, you know, leaves dry up. So within a day or two, so it's like Adam and Eve would be, most of their day would be spent making clothes for the following day. Okay, to make clothes in the evening so that they keep the leaves overnight so that they don't dry up. And then in the morning they strap themselves. By three, the leaves are dry again, so they have to keep. So God in his mercy took an animal, killed it, shed the blood, and then he made some coverings. Skin covering. A skin covering is better. It covers better, and it doesn't have to be sewn every day. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's a revelation about what you're saying, that when we see that things God can't do without man, we take away sovereignty.
Yes.
That makes a lot of sense, because some people say, you know, unless we pray that things that won't happen. But we find there are a lot of things happening.
Yeah, and remember, we don't always know what to pray for, and there are things that God hides from us, and there are things God will do that surprise us. So in my walk with God, I've learned to pray, yes, and to do my part. But at the back of my mind, I always depend on the sovereignty of God. That I'll tell God, okay, I'm limited. Sometimes I'm even weak. I don't even pray enough like I should. And that's where sometimes God will even raise other people to pray for you when you don't know. That is his sovereignty. So although you are not praying yourself, other people are praying for you without your knowledge. And God will just come and do something that you never even thought he would do it. And we are surprised.
Yes.
Okay? So it's good, yes, to know that. And again, we can't use that as an excuse not to do our part. Remember, when we know, because ignorance is no excuse. When we know, then God expects us to do it. But when we don't know, or we are weak and we are not able, then that's when the sovereignty of God kicks in. You have heard of a story where someone was walking in a dream, was walking on the beach. Then they go to a place, he saw, okay, he could see his feet and the feet of God. God's feet were very big on the sand, and his were small. Then when they go to a place, the small feet disappeared. And then it was just the big feet. Then he asked, what does that mean? He said, at this point, I was walking with you. But when we go there, you got tired. I carried you. So I was walking alone there. You were not walking with me. So that's how the sovereignty of God works. God wants to walk with us. But there will be moments that God himself knows that as human beings, we are weak. And that is what makes him God, so that we can depend and rely on him. Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
Mm. Yes. We want to look into also the church and governance, which I believe God has put upon on that aspect.
Yes.
Things to do with elders, deacons, and pastors. So what role do they play in the New Testament church?
Okay. In the New Testament, there are two different offices that God has set in the church for the rule and service of his people, elders and deacons. Basically, those are the two major offices. And eldership basically refers to the divinely appointed ministry of watching over, protecting, guiding, feeding, and ruling God's people in the way that God wants that to be done. So it's important that we start by saying these are divinely appointed ministries. And that brings in now the divine protocol, that we need to appreciate that as a church, that church elders are not just appointed because they are good people, or they impress the pastor, or they are influential in society. We need to know that even when we do that, we need to ensure that the appointment of God is involved, either through prayer or whichever other indicators that we are going to use to ensure that we don't end up just choosing people politically. Because I think the issue here is we need to be careful not to bring, you know, the issue of political correctness within church leadership, because the church, as it degenerates into an institution, these offices begin to get more political than spiritual. And that's where divine protocol ends. Because you have leaders who are not necessarily qualified to be elders, but because it's an institution, they become leaders. And that has been one of the challenges of leading the church, because then the church is led by carnal, earthly people who do not understand the heart of God concerning the church. So they will be more involved in building the institution as an entity as opposed to building the people who are the members of the family of God.
You see that? There that is raising my eyes. You see, when the church degenerates to an institution.
Yeah.
Okay. Mm. So it's not supposed to be
all. It's supposed to be both. Okay, but the foundational form of the church,
yes,
is a spiritual family of God's people. The institution contains the physical realities of manifestation, because you need an institution,
yes,
to, because we can't exist in a vacuum.
Mm-hmm.
We need, for example, land like we have here.
Mm-hmm.
We need the church building.
Mm-hmm.
We need the offices.
Mm-hmm.
We need the rooms that we hold the other meetings.
Yes.
So now that brings the institutional element. And then when the people come together here to work,
mm-hmm,
we need coordination. We need someone to take care of the church finances.
Mm-hmm.
We need an accountant. We need an administrator.
Yes.
To help us manage the buildings here and the things that we do and the planning.
Mm-hmm.
That's the institutional part of it.
Mm-hmm.
But you see, that can easily take precedence, and we start running the institution more than actually running the church, where people are not being pastored, they are not being nourished, they are not being discipled,
mm-hmm,
but the institution is there. It does, and it happens everywhere. Every institution, including ours, must keep fighting that spirit. Because the reason why you find that churches begin well and they are doing the work of God, they are discipling people, they are reaching out, they are evangelizing, they get to a place whereby they become an institution. So the maintenance and the protection of the institution becomes, preoccupies the leaders more than the Great Commission.
Oh, yes.
Yes.
I hear you. Then there's a very important part you've touched there. This happens in churches, the choosing of the elders.
Mm.
And then I'll come also to the elders, because there's a way you've put it and there's a way we used to see the elders. That sometimes, either because someone has been too long in the church, or someone has money, or someone has particular or charismatic personality, without seeing the God factor about it, or how God wired them to work.
Yeah. Because eldership is a divine function. And it's because remember I said,
mm-hmm,
they are set by God,
mm-hmm,
in the church to rule.
Mm-hmm.
Ruling,
mm-hmm,
the word rule, when it is applied to the church, especially in the New Testament, it talks about the oversight, shepherd-like oversight, you know, over God's people. You know, shepherds, what they do? Shepherds love the sheep. They care for the sheep. They protect the sheep. They feed the sheep. You understand?